series of non-ferrous metal. I'm going to start with the aluminium. Aluminium and its alloys. Aluminium is obtained from bauxite ore, which is found in various parts of the world and principally in the Arkansas in the United States. Because it is a hydrated oxide of aluminium having the chemical formula Al2O3 2S2O, the bauxite ore is given a caustic treatment known as the Bayer process, which reduces the ore to a powder called alumina or aluminium oxide. The alumina is mixed with a catalyst called cryolite, and the mixture is placed in carbon lined tanks which are equipped with large carbon anodes. A high level of electric current is applied, and this causes the carbon of the electrode to combine with the oxygen in the alumina to form carbon dioxide in bracket CO2 gas. The metallic aluminium which is left settles to the bottom of the tank and is dissolved in the forms of ingots. The electric current flowing through the mixture generates a high temperature about 1900 degree Fahrenheit in bracket 1038 degree centigrade, which makes the process possible. The pure aluminium obtained from the refining process has various other methods mixed with it to form the many alloys which are available. Since the day of the silk and wire airplanes, aluminium has been the principal structural metal for aircraft. Pure aluminium was much too soft for structural use, and so alloys were developed to provide for the strength and stiffness required. I have missed to say that in non-ferrous metal means which have element other than iron as their base or principal constituent. This group includes such metals as aluminium, titanium, copper and magnesium, as well as such alloyed metals as monel and babbit. Now, aluminium and aluminium alloys. Commercially, pure aluminium is a white lustrous metal which stands second in the scale of malleability, sixth in the ductility, and ranks high in its resistance to corrosion. Aluminium combined with various percentage of other metals forms alloy which are used in aircraft constructions. Aluminium alloy in which the principal alloy ingredients are either manganese, chromium or magnesium and silicon, so little attack in corrosive environment. Alloys in which substantial percentage of copper and are used are more susceptible to corrosive action. The total percentage of alloying element is seldom more than 6 or 7% in the wrought alloys. Aluminium is one of the most widely used metals in modern aircraft construction. It is vital to the aviation industry because of the high strength to weight ratio and its comparative ease of fabrication. The outstanding characteristic of aluminium is its lightweight. Aluminium melts at the temperature 1250 degree Fahrenheit. It is non-magnetic and an excellent conductor. Now, commercially, pure aluminium has a tensile strength of about 13,000 psi, but by rolling or other cold working processes, its strength may be approximately doubled. By alloying with other metals or by using heat treating processes, the tensile strength may be raised to as high as 65,000 psi or to within the strength range of structural steel. Aluminium alloy, although strong, are easily worked because they are malleable and ductile. They may be rolled into sheets as thin as 0.0017 inch or drawn into wire 0.004 inch in diameter. Most aluminium alloy sheets stock used in aircraft construction ranges from 0.016 to 0.096 inch in thickness. However, some of the larger aircraft use sheet stock which may be as thick as 0.356 inch. The various types of aluminium may be divided into two general classes. Number one, the casting alloy, in bracket those suitable for casting in sand permanent mold or die castings. And number two, the wrought alloy, in bracket those which may be shaped by rolling, drawing or forging. Of these two, the wrought alloys are the most widely used in aircraft construction, being used for stringers, bulkheads, skin, rivets and extruded section. Aluminium casting alloys are divided into two basic groups. One, the physical properties of the alloys are determined by the alloying elements and cannot be changed after the metal is cast. In the other, the alloying elements make it possible to heat treat the casting to produce the desired physical properties. Now, number one, the casting alloys are identified by a letter preceding the alloy number. When a letter precedes a number, it indicates a slight variation in the composition of the original alloy. This variation in composition is simply to impart some desirable quality in casting alloy 214. For example, the addition of zinc to improve its pouring qualities is indicated by the letter A in front of the number, thus creating the designation A214. When castings have been heat treated, the heat treatment and the compositions of the casting is indicated by the letter capital T followed by the alloying number. An example of this is the sand casting alloy 355, which has several different compositions and tempers and is designated by 355-T6, 355-T51 or C3555-T51. Aluminium alloys casting are produced by one of the three basic methods. Number one is sand mold, number two is permanent mold, or third is die cast. In casting aluminium, it must be remembered that in most cases, different types of alloys must be used for different types of castings. Sand casting and die casting require different types of alloy than those used in permanent molds. Sand and permanent mold castings are parts produced by pouring molten metal into a previously prepared mold, allowing the metal to solidify or freeze, and then removing the part. If the mold is made up of sand, the part is a sand casting. If it is a metallic mold, in bracket usually cast iron, the part is a permanent mold casting. Sand and permanent casting are produced by pouring liquid metal into the mold, the metal flowing under the force of gravity alone. The two principal types of sand casting alloy are 112 and 212. Little difference exists between the two metals from a mechanical properties standpoint, since both are adaptable to a wide range of products. The permanent mold process is a later development of the sand casting process. The major differences being the material from which the molds are made. The advantage of this process is that there are fewer openings, in bracket called porosity, than in sand casting. The sand are the binder which is mixed with the sand to hold it together, give off a certain amount of gas which causes porosity in a sand casting. Permanent mold castings are used to obtain higher mechanical properties, better surfaces, or more accurate dimensions. There are two specific types of permanent mold casting. Number one is the permanent metal mold with metal cores, and number two, the semi-permanent types containing sand cores. Because finer grain structure is produced in alloy subjected to rapid cooling of metal molds, they are far superior to the sand type casting. Alloys 122, age 132 and 142 are commonly used in permanent mold castings. The principal uses of which are in internal combustion engines. Die casting used in aircraft are usually aluminium or die casting used in aircraft are usually aluminium or magnesium alloy. If the weight is of primary importance, magnesium alloy is used because it is lighter than aluminium alloy. Aluminium alloy is frequently used since it is stronger than most magnesium alloys. A die casting is produced by forcing molten metal under pressure into a metallic die and allowing it to solidify. Then the die is opened and the part removed. The basic difference between permanent mold casting and die casting is that in the permanent mold process, metal flown into the die under gravity. In the die casting operation, the metal is forced under great pressure. Die castings are used where relatively large production of a given part is involved. Remember, any shape which can be forged can be cast. Wrought aluminium and wrought aluminium alloys are divided into two general classes, non-heat treatable alloys and heat treatable alloys. Non-heat treatable alloys are those in which the mechanical properties are determined by the amount of cold work introduced after the final annealing operation. The mechanical properties obtained by cold working are destroyed by any subsequent heating and cannot be restored except by additional cold working, which is not always possible. The full hard temper is produced by the maximum amount of cold work that is commercially practicable. Metal is in the as fabricated condition is produced from the ingot without any subsequent controlled amount of cold working or thermal treatment. There is consequently a variable amount of strain hardening depending upon the thickness of the section. For heat treatable aluminium alloys, the mechanical properties are obtained by heat treating to a suitable temperature, holding at that temperature long enough to allow the alloying constituent to enter into solid solution, and then quenching to hold the constituent in solution. The metal is left in a supersaturated unstable state and is then age hardened either by natural aging at room temperature or by artificial aging at some elevated temperature. Now, aluminium alloy designations. Wrought aluminium and wrought aluminium alloys are designated by a 4-digit index system. The systems are broken into 3 distinct groups: 1 cross 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 groups, 2 cross 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 through 8 cross 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 group, and 9 cross 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 group in bracket, which is at present unused, bracket closed. The first digit is a designation identifies the alloy's type. The second indicates specific alloy modifications. Should the second number be 0, it would indicate no special control over the individual impurities. Digits 1 through 9, however, when assigned consecutively as needed for the second number in this group, indicate the number of controls over individual impurities in the metal. The last two digits of the 1 cross 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 group are used to indicate the hundredths of 1% above the original 99% designated by the first digit. Thus, if the last two digits were 30, the alloy would contain 99% plus 0.30% of pure aluminium. Or a total of 99.30% pure aluminium. Example of alloys in this known as two cross 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 through eight cross 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 alloy groups. The second digit in the alloy designation indicates alloy modification. If the second digit is zero, it indicates the original alloy, while the digits 1 through 9 indicate alloy modifications. The last two of the four digits in the designation identify the different alloys in the group. For this, I am giving you a figure for your reference. Identifications were used, the temper designation followed, the alloy designation are and is separated from it by a dash, that is 7075-T6, 2024-T4, etc. The temper designation consists of a letter indicating the basic temper, which may be more specifically defined by the addition of one or more digits. This designation are as follows. Digit following the designation H1, H2 and H3 indicate the degree of strain hardening. Number 8 represent the ultimate tensile strength equal to that achieved by cold reduction of approximately 75% following a full melt anneal, 0 representing the annealed state. Now, heat treatment identification. In the wrought form, commercially pure aluminium is known as 1100. It has a high degree of resistance to corrosion and is easily formed into intricate shapes. It is relatively low in strength and does not have the properties required for structural aircraft parts. High strengths are generally obtained by the process of alloying. The resulting alloys are less easily formed and, with some exceptions, have lower resistance to corrosion than 1100 aluminium. Alloying is not the only method of increasing the strength of aluminium. Like other metals, aluminium becomes stronger and harder as it can be rolled, formed or otherwise cold worked. Since the hardness depends on the amount of the cold working done, 1100 and some wrought aluminium alloys are available in several strain hardened temperatures. The soft or annealed condition is designated 0 if the material is straight hardened. It is said to be in the edge condition. The most widely used alloys in aircraft conditions are hardened by heat treatment rather than by cold worked. Alloys are designated by the somewhat different set of symbols, -T4 and W, indicate solution heat treated and quenched but not aged, and T6 indicates an alloy in the heat treated hardened condition. Additional digits may be added to T1 through T10 to indicate a variation in treatment which significantly alters the characteristic of the product. In the wrought form, commercially pure aluminium is known as 1100. It has a high degree of resistance to corrosion and is easily formed into intricate shapes. It is relatively low in strength, however, and does not have the strength required for structural aircraft parts. Higher strengths are generally obtained by the process of alloying. The resulting alloys are less easily formed and with some exception have lower resistance to corrosion than 1100 aluminium. Alloy is not only method of increasing the strength of aluminium. Like other materials, aluminium becomes stronger and harder as it is rolled, formed or otherwise cold worked. Since the hardness depends on the amount of cold working done, 1100 and some wrought aluminium alloys are available in several steel hardened temples. The soft of annealed condition is designated capital O. If the material is strain hardened, it is said to be in the capital H condition. The most widely used in alloys in aircraft constructions are hardened by heat treatment rather than by cold work. These alloys are designated by a somewhat different set of symbols, that is like dash T4 and W indicate solution heat treated and quenched but not aged, and T6 indicates an alloy in the heat treated hardened condition. Aluminium alloy sheets are marked with the specification numbers on approximately every square foot of material. If for any reason this identification is not on the material, it is possible to separate the heat treatable alloys from the non-heat treatable alloys by immersing a sample of the material in a 10% solution of caustic soda in bracket sodium hydroxide. The heat treatable alloys will turn black due to the copper content, whereas the other will remain bright. In the case of clad material, the surface will remain bright, but this will be a dark area in the middle where viewed from the edge. Now, what is alclad aluminium? It is very important to understand. The term alclad or pure clad are used to designate sheets that consist of an aluminium alloy core coated with a layer of pure aluminium to a depth of approximately 5.5% on each side. The pure aluminium coating affords a dual protection for the core, preventing contact with any corrosive agents and protecting the core electrolytically by preventing any attack caused by scratching or from other abrasions.